Welcome back, students. Today we are going to discuss a very interesting topic that is called biomolecules. Biomolecules are the organic compounds present as essential constituent of living organisms in different cells. They build up all the living systems and are responsible for their growth, maintenance, and their ability to reproduce. Carbohydrates, amino acids and proteins, nucleic acids, lipids, fats, nearly all the compounds in the cells are made up of carbon, hydrogen, oxygen, nitrogen, phosphorus, sulfur. Now I am repeating once more: carbohydrates, amino acids and proteins, nucleic acids, lipids and fats. These are the essential biomolecules. So let's talk about the carbohydrates. Now the carbohydrates are divided into three major classes depending upon whether or not they undergo hydrolysis, and if they do so, how many number of products are formed. So carbohydrates are composed of carbon, hydrogen and oxygen, and chemically speaking they are of two types. Either they are aldehydes or ketones. So essentially they carry a carbonyl group. So first class is monosaccharides. They are what? They are one sugar molecules. Okay? But they are one, like glucose, fructose, galactose, mannose, idose, like that. Then disaccharides. Disaccharide means there are two sugar molecules will be there. That is sucrose, lactose, maltose, etc. Then we have oligosaccharides. Oligosaccharides have 2 to 10 sugar molecules in them, like raffinose, stachose. Then we have polysaccharides. They have 10 or more sugar molecule in them, like starch, glycogen, cellulose. So monosaccharides are, so what can we say about carbohydrate? They are the monosaccharides are polyhydroxy aldehydes or polyhydroxyketones, which cannot be decomposed by hydrolysis to give simpler hydrocarbons or simpler carbohydrates. Examples are glucose and fructose, both of which have molecular formula C6H12O6. So if you take glucose or fructose and hydrolyze, what will we observe? We will observe no reaction in them. Are you getting that? Sure. Got that. I am drawing now. This is this compound is known as what? This compound is known as glyceraldehyde. Next compound is known as what? Now, what can you observe? If both the OH are on the same side, this compound is called as erythriose. Now, what are you finding in erythriose? That both the hydroxy are on the same side. Okay, if one of the hydroxy is on the left hand side, that is upper hydrogen, that is the next to the carbonyl group, then it will called thiose. Okay, we have already discussed that. Next sugar is what? Next is, this is called ribose. This is ribose. Now all the OH are on the same side. Now if one of the OH is replaced by H, it is called as deoxyribose. So ribose is present in RNA, and if this OH has been replaced by H, then it is called as deoxyribose. Okay, the immediate next is that is glucose. Now you can easily see that here the third carbon atom has OH on the other side. The compound is called glucose. Now all of these compounds are derived from glyceraldehyde. If in case of glyceraldehyde, this lowest OH is on the right hand side, it is called as D series, capital D. D series of compound. And if this OH on the left hand side. So if you observe easily here, I have drawn two types of glyceraldehyde. One is called D series of glyceraldehyde, other is L series of glyceraldehyde. Now what you will observe here that in one case the OH is on the right hand side, and in second case OH on the left hand side of the carbon. Now in stereochemistry, what has been now established that the stereogenic center that is furthest from the carbonyl group, if it happens on the right hand side, it is called as D series. And if the OH that is attached to the carbon atom, and that should be stereogenic also, if that is furthest from the carbonyl group and lies on the left hand side of carbon, then it should be called as L series. Now this D series and L series does not mean dextrorotatory and levorotatory. It's simply called the relative configuration. If compound which can be prepared from D series of glyceraldehyde or can be converted into D series of glyceraldehyde is belongs to D series, and a compound which can be prepared from L glyceraldehyde or can be changed into L glyceraldehyde, then that compound belongs to L series. So D and L series is called as the relative configuration of the compound. Okay, so you should not mixed up with the optical activity. So it should not be mixed with the optical activity. D series and L series means that whether a given set of compound can be prepared from D glyceraldehyde or can be converted to D glyceraldehyde, then it belongs to D series. Are you sure about that? Or in simple words, the stereogenic center of the compound that is furthest from the carbonyl group, if lies on the right hand side or showing R configuration, R here means absolute configuration now, then the compound should be belongs to D series. And if the stereogenic center that is furthest from the carbonyl group lies on the left hand side of the carbon, then the compound belongs to the L series or D series. So D series and L series is the name of the two sugar groups, two sugar series. And you have to remember that all natural occurring sugars are D sugars. I am repeating once more, all natural occurring sugars are belongs to D sugar. So D and L are what? D and L should be called as the relative configuration. Like I can give you one more example that what can happen, that you take D glyceraldehyde, you have taken now D glyceraldehyde and prepare the two compounds. Now if you increase the number of carbon here, the next carbon will develop the so here it is 1 2 3 it is 1 2 3 4 so here 3 carbon in acetaldehyde but 4 carbon in S compound similarly here you can see so 4 and 1 it is 2 3 now what happens there now since the compound derived from that D compound this carbon will have what same configuration the new generated carbon it is shown by red color that is the new generated carbon here now it can give you two types of configuration if OH lies on the same side that of the previous OH and OH lies on the other side so this compound is known as what this compound is known as D erythrose and this compound is known as D3-ose here 2OH on the opposite side 2OH on the same side but both belongs to what both belongs to the same series DY because both are derived from what both are derived from the D glyceraldehyde so remember that so now the new generated carbon will have different configuration this carbon now have different configuration I am talking about absolute configuration but they belong to the same family which family that is their relative family is D glyceraldehyde series so what is that both of them belongs to D sugar although both of them are now different compounds why because now both of them are derived from the same D glyceraldehyde now what can you say that now again we will repeat that carbohydrates are what carbohydrates are sugars and starches they are main source of energy in many organisms serves to store energy and are structural components in some organisms because of their wide distribution carbohydrates are the most abundant of the biomolecules so when you talk about carbohydrate then in most of the organisms it is the you can say the most important form to get energy now first is about the carbohydrate formula and structures so most carbohydrate have the general formula CH2ON so if you increase the number of n you will get the answer okay this suggests that they were hydrates of carbon and hence named carbohydrates however they are not hydrates of carbon nor do all carbohydrates conform to this formula carbohydrates are fundamentally polyhydroxyaldehydes or ketones and may contain sometimes some nitrogen phosphorus or sulfur so first they have to be classified on the basis of their simple presence monosaccharides are simplest sugar and containing 3 to 7 carbon and only one aldehyde or ketone group I am repeating once more monosaccharides are what monosaccharides are the compounds which are containing 3 to 7 carbon groups you can say erythrose arbinose glucose fructose okay mannose then you have keto tetrose or keto pentose like that all those have are what they are classified as what they are classified as monosaccharides oligosaccharide consists of 2 to 10 monosaccharides unit joined together they are further classified as disaccharides okay so disaccharides may be contain 2 to 10 so in that one class is disaccharide So oligosaccharide consists of 2 to 10 monosaccharides only. Then we have polysaccharides, which are very large and have hundreds or thousands of monosaccharides units joined together either in a linear fashion or in a cross-member fashion. Now, most important property of monosaccharide is that in case of monosaccharides, their general properties are what? They are white solids, water soluble, and often have a very sweet taste. Now they have formula what? CH2O, and where n can be from 3 to 7. The most often the numbers are 5 to 6. The carbon skeleton is unbalanced, connected by single bonds. One carbon contains a carbonyl group, all other carbon contains a hydroxyl group. The monosaccharides are, now what can happen? On the top of the carbon, top or the next carbon may contain the carbonyl group. If the top carbon contains the carbonyl group, it should be called as aldose. And if the second carbon contains a carbonyl group, then it should be called as ketose. Monosaccharides are often suffixed with the name O's. Every monosaccharide can be classified as aldose or ketose depending upon the function group. Three carbon atoms called triose, four carbon called tetrose, five is called pentose, six is called hexose, and seven is called heptose. The two classifications are often be called as aldopentose and aldohexose. These are the most important that you are going to study now. I already discussed with you the structure and stereochemistry, that if the OH belongs to the right hand side, it is called as diglyceraldehyde, and EF and OH on the left hand side, it should be called as L-glyceraldehyde. We have already discussed that portion with you. Are you okay with that? So glyceraldehyde contains a chiral or asymmetrical carbon atom, so they should be referred to as stereogenic or chiral center. So all glyceraldehyde, or you can say all the carbohydrate, they are what? They are optically active polyhydroxy compound. They are optically active polyhydroxy compound, and designated as what? Either D or L. Okay, I told you in length already. What about D and L? Now a molecule with the N chiral center will have 2 power N stereo isomer will be there. Okay, yes or no? So thus a 4 carbon aldose will give you 2 stereo centers and 4 stereo isomerism. Like here you 1, 2. So 2 stereo centers are there, 2 power 2 belongs to what? 4. Why? Because there is no planar symmetry or center symmetry in these molecules. Okay, so you may have 4 isomer. Are you sure about that? Clear? So what are those 4? They are the 3-O's, L-3-O's and L-erythreos. So these are the 4 what? These are the 4 stereoisomer belongs to that compound. These two structures are D group and configuration belongs to third carbon linked to diglyceraldehyde. The other two structures are L-glucose, because they resembles what? L-glucose. But most of the natural occurring glucose, or you can say like glucose or fructose or ribose or arbinose, they all belongs to what? They all belongs to D series. I am repeating once more, the 2 power N formula is only occurs when the compound does not have any element of symmetry. Okay, and in most of the carbohydrates you will find that they do not have any element of symmetry. Now one most important thing is that D sugars are biologically very important. Why? Because we consume D glucose. Okay, so D series of the glucose are very very important. Now we have, first of all we talked about the 3-O's. Now we talked about the next carbon. So 3-O's has 2 stereo centers, 2 carbon has stereo center. Now let's talk about ribose. Ribose has how many? Ribose has 3 carbon atom as what? 3 carbon atom as the stereo center. 1, 2, 3. Okay. Now the
if you see that here, the next compound is arbinose. Arbinose has what? Arbinose has different configuration around the carbon in comparison to what? In comparison to ribose. Similarly, if you take, here you take what? Here you take xylose. Xylose is what? Xylose has this carbon configuration different from the others. Okay? Xylose and ribose, they have same configuration at carbon number 2 and carbon number 4. But carbon number 3, they have different what? They have different configuration. Similarly, in lyoxos, what happens? You can easily see that at carbon number 4, the ribose has the same configuration as that of lyoxos. But at carbon number 2 and carbon number 3, they have different configuration. Are you sure? So there are 4 aldo pentose and 8 aldo hexose. And the same number of L isomers are also existing there. Are you sure about that? So you have to keep on account that they have different configuration at different carbon atom, although all of them have an equal number of carbon atom. Similarly, you can take one more example of that. The compound is C6H12O6. Okay, glucose can be what? It can be in 8 different isomeric form. Here we are discussing the glucose and the galactose form. Now here you can see that this is atom number 1, that is atom number 6. So that is 1 and that is 6. Now if you look very carefully at carbon number 2, they have the same configuration. Okay, at carbon number 3, they also have the same configuration. But at carbon number 4, they have a different configuration. So that's how the glucose and galactose are different. Remember that later on we will study about that. Beta glucose and beta galactose, they are combined together to give you lactose. Lactose is the name of the milk sugar. Okay? So you have to memorize this thing very well. Now what you are observing here, that at carbon number 5 also they have the same configuration. So the previous examples of these are ribose, arbinose, xylose, lyoxols, and here you can see in case of glucose and galactose, these compound, now let us suppose glucose and galactose, they differ in configuration around in one carbon atom. So they are called as what? They are called aptamers. They are called as what? Aptamers. Remembering that. Okay. So the compounds which have the same number or same type of configuration at all the carbon atom except at one carbon atom, they are called as aptamers. They are called as what? Aptamers. So D-glucose and D-galactose, they are aptamers at what? They are aptamers at carbon number 4. Are you sure? Now if I draw here what? If I draw here mannose also, this is mannose I am drawing now, CH2H. Now here what can we find? That glucose and what? Mannose have different configuration at what? At carbon number 1. Are you sure about that? Now here can you see one more example, that is of the ketose. Now simplest ketose has a formula CH2OH. Now here you can see easily that this is dihydroxyacetone, but that compound is not optically active. Why? Because none of the carbon is chiral carbon. So it does not have D or L forms of the compound. But if you add a fourth carbon atom, then a stereogenic center has been generated. So it is related here at carbon, is at carbon number 3 there. Okay, so that is called as what? If OH is on the right hand side, it is called deerythriolose, and if OH on the left hand side, it is called as what? It is called as L erythriolose. Similarly, in that case, what can you observe? You can easily observe that D and L configurations are based on what? D and L configuration based on glyceraldehyde. Okay, because the furthest atom from the, you can say, carbonyl group is on what side? On that cases it will be depend. So here you can see what? Here now you have two carbon atoms. Like in erythrolose, you will have only one carbon atom as stereogenic center. Here you have two. So compound is what? Ribolose. And then you have this OH and this OH on the different side of the carbon atom. Although the last carbon, that is stereo center, has the same configuration, but this middle one has what? That is just below the keto group. It has different configuration. So the compound is what? Hexylose. Okay. Now if that configuration is again reversed and revert back to original one, but the last carbon atom, that is stereo center, has been what? It has been reverted like that. You will get a new compound. That is L hexylose. Why it is so? Because OH on what? I am repeating once more so that you can able to understand that. These OH on the different side of what? These OH on the different side of the carbon. Okay? Sure about that? Similarly, here also, this compound is what? L ribulose. So, D ribulose and L ribulose, and D hexylose and L hexylose. You have to memorize all those things. Now, reactions of the monosaccharide, that is very, very important. Okay, the first case is the oxidation. Remember that aldehydes, they respond to Fehling test and Benedict test, but ketones do not respond to these tests. Okay, sure. So first will be the distinguished test. So Fehling and Benedict. Fehling test is what? Fehling solution is a mixture of alkaline copper sulfate and sodium potassium tartrate. While Benedict solution, it is basic copper sulfate plus sodium potassium citrate. That is the only difference they have. That one is the salt of tartaric acid, other is the salt of what? Citric acid. Copper sulfate is the main thing here. So in both the cases, copper plus 2 transform into copper plus 1. And who will provide that electron? The electron will be provided by the aldehyde. So aldehyde transform into carboxylic acid, and copper 2 plus salt transform into copper plus 1 salt. So a red PPT of Cu2O, cuprous oxide, is the distinguished. Ketones do not give this test, but aldehyde respond to Fehling and Benedict test. One more important thing that you have to memorize in your mind is that benzaldehyde gives Fehling test, but does not give Benedict test. Fehling test and Benedict test, but gives the tolerance test. I'm repeating once more. Benzaldehyde does not give Fehling and Benedict test, but gives tolerance test. The reason being that in Fehling and Benedict test, what you have observed? You have observed that in both Fehling and Benedict test, copper 2 plus ion is involved. But in case of tolerance, what happens? Ag plus ion is silver ion is involved. So silver plus 1 ion has greater E naught value than the copper 2 plus value. So E naught values of Ag plus 1 is much, much more greater than the E naught values of copper 2 plus 1. So that's why what happens? Aldehydes can be, aldehyde of the benzaldehyde group can be oxidized by what? tolerance, but not by failing and benefiting. But here, very interesting point, but we have to observe that here what happens? Here in this case, aldehyde transform into carboxylic acid. Now, if sugar is in aldose, the aldehyde directly oxidizes to acid. If the sugar is a ketose, then what happens? Then ketose also, if it is an alpha hydroxy ketose, if it is an alpha hydroxy ketone, then it undergo rearrangement and gives you an aldehyde. That rearrangement is known as Lobry-De Bruyne-Ekstein rearrangement. So, this very interesting question is being asked in the examination. Fructose is a ketone, but it gives tolerance test and failing test. Why? The reason being that fructose is a alpha hydroxy ketone. So, alpha hydroxy ketone under basic condition, alpha hydroxy ketone under basic condition undergo tautomerism. Undergo what? Undergo tautomerism to give you what? To give you an aldehyde. Like if you take fructose there and alkaline condition is why? Because it is basic copper sulfate is there. So after some time it transforms into an equilibrium mixture of mannose, glucose and fructose. Mannose and glucose both are aldehydes. So what will happen? Since under basic condition, fructose is able to produce both aldehydes, that is mannose and glucose. So fructose will respond to what? Benedict and Fehling test. So remember that. I will after in the next class I will teach you about this rearrangement, okay? Because it is a very important topic that how a fructose or any alpha hydroxy ketone undergo tautomerization. So when you have a terminal alpha hydroxy ketone, that can be tautomerized to give you what? That can be tautomerized to give you an aldehyde group. Now let's look at the reaction of what? Reaction of the bromine water with the glucose. Now what can happen? When bromine dissolved in water, that is a very weak oxidizing. That is very weak what? That is a very weak oxidizing agent here. So when bromine in water, okay, it is a weaker oxidizing agent than the benedict region. So will oxidize aldose but cannot oxidize ketose. This have to be memorized. I told you that benedict and Fehling can give you what, despite being fructose a ketone, will give you a test. Because of the tautomerization, it will transform into an equilibrium mixture of glucose and mannose, and glucose and mannose are aldehyde. So that is not only in case of fructose, that can happen in any case which have alpha hydroxy group to the keto group. If a alpha hydroxy group is there to the keto group, it will undergo tautomerism. Now, if you treat bromine water, then what will happen? Then what can we see that glucose, if N is here 4, it becomes a glucose. Then glucose will transform into what? Gluconic acid. Put N equal to 4, then you will get. But N is anything. N can be 2, N can be 1, N can be 3, 4, 5, anything. So, but in each and every case, you will get aldehyde group transform into a carboxylic group. So, bromine water reaction to produce a carboxylic linkage, it confirm one thing. What is that confirm one thing? That the terminal group is an aldehyde group. Because bromine water being a weak oxidizing agent, it can only oxidize the aldehyde group to the carboxylic group. It can't convert anything, it can't convert primary alcoholic group or secondary alcoholic group or any ketone. I'm repeating once more, bromine water can oxidize what? Bromine water only oxidized only oxidize what happen? Aldehyde group. Remember that. Are you sure about that? That you have to memorize. Second is that dilute HNO3. Now what does, here also you can take N equal to 4. Now nitric acid being a very strong oxygen in comparison to bromine or in comparison to baryonic and tollens also, it will convert both aldehyde and primary alcohol. So aldehyde transform into carboxylic acid and this primary alcohol also transform into what? Carboxylic acid. So you will get what? You will get a saccharic acid here. If N is 4, remember that. It is applicable to all aldose. I am repeating once more. It is applicable to all aldose. But if it is general equation there now, if you put N equal to 4, then the reactant becomes glucose, product becomes saccharic acid. Okay, are you sure? Clear? Because if you will take ketones, then what will happen? Ketone, in case of ketones, oxidation is not so easy. So, in general name, the product is an aldric acid or glyceric acid with specific name like ribaric acid or glucuric acid. For ketones, oxidation occurs with the chain breaking. Remember that. Okay. Popoff rule I told you already in ketones. Okay. So, oxidation of ketones follow the Popoff rule. Or oxidation of the aldehyde follow one more rule, that is the per iodate rule. So remembering that, reaction with bromine water confirms that one aldehyde group is present at terminal. Reaction with nitric acid confirms that there is one aldehyde group at the terminal and one primary alcohol group at the terminal. So that's how the structure of glucose can be confirmed. Now, a reaction with what? HIO4. IO4, that is known as per iodate ion. It has a good tendency to oxidize what? To tendency to oxidize consecutive COH bond or consecutive OH bond or consecutive CNH2COOH bonds. So, wherever you have consecutive OH bond or a keto hydroxy bond or a NH2OH bond, in all those cases, what would you find? You would find that IO4, that is per iodate ion, will oxidize that. So, iodine from plus 7, I'm repeating once more, iodine plus 7 becomes plus 5. So per iodate becomes iodate. This is iodate ion. And that is per iodate ion. So IO4 negative is per iodate. It is what? Per iodate ion. And IO3 is iodate ion. So plus 7 becomes plus 5. And that aldehyde becomes, that alcohol becomes either aldehyde or ketones. That alcohol becomes aldehyde ketones, or that keto can become carboxylic acid. So this is very, very important. You have to keep in your mind that this is very, very important question. So IO4 rupture, it breaks. IO4 negative ruptures and breaks consecutive and oxidized. Not only the carbon-carbon bond is broken, but carbon OH bond or carbon oxygen bond get oxidized also. Okay, so this group transform into carbonyl group, keto group transform into acidic group, and acidic group transform into CO2 group. This is the reaction of what? Reaction of IO4. Okay, I am repeating once more. Wherever there is consecutive COOH linkages or carbonyl OH linkages or amino OH linkages, in all the cases iodate ion will break the carbon-carbon bond and also oxidize it.
right? When dealing with monosaccharides, every carbon has oxidizable group and so all carbon-carbon bond are broken. The result is mixture of one carbon compounds and all following rules. 1 mole of HI consumed per cc broken. 1 mole of CHO will be formed by primary. 1 mole of formic acid formed by secondary. 1 mole of formic acid formed by per aldehyde. And 1 mole of CO2 formed by per ketone or per acids. So that you have to keep in your mind. Are you okay with that? Now let's look at example of glucose here. So what can happen? This consecutive, so there is what? There is aldehyde group is here. So that bond will be broken. Okay? And transform into what? So transform into, this is one. Carbon number one transform into carboxylation. Now carbon number two is also oxidized. That is two. Because two oxidation happening from two sides, it will transform into formic acid. Here also carbon number 3, it will oxidize from both the ends, this end. So what will happen? You will again will have one molecule of formic acid. Now carbon number 4 also get oxidized from two sides. Okay, so you will have fourth molecule of what? Fourth molecule of carboxylic, that is the formic acid. Again, fifth atom, that is also oxidized from, how many sides? From both sides. That is both sides means two oxidation. So how many you will have? You will have again formic acid. And last is this primary alcohol group. It's only oxidation undergo from first side. Only one side. So it will transform into what? It will transform into formaldehyde. So here, how many carbon bonds are broken? 1, 2, 3, 4 and 5. So 5 moles of IO4 negative has been consumed. Okay. So from the products, the amount of IO4 used can be deducted. Are you getting that or not? That is very, very important. That is very, very important question. I am repeating once more. Not only here. In aldehyde ketones and in polyhydroxy compound, this type of questions are very, very popular in determining the structural determination order. So while in IIT mains and advanced, you will get most of the questions depending upon this property. Next is about reduction. Aldose can be reduced to aldetols by using reducing agent like borohydride. So what happened? Sodium borohydride will do what? It will produce aldehyde to what? Primary alcoholic group. So what will happen? It will transform this into primary alcoholic group. Similarly, ozone. That is very, very important question. I will tell you in the next class. I will tell you two important things in next class. One is about the Van Eckenstein rearrangement. That how a ketone can give you an aldehydic test, and second about the ozone. So these two very, very important properties will be discussed in the next class. Aldose react with phenyl hydrazine to form phenyl hydrazone. Okay, so what can happen? Both aldehyde, remember that this reaction is important. Why? Because both glucose and fructose will give you same type of ozone. I'm repeating once more. Both glucose and fructose will give you same type of ozone. Now since we are talking about glucose, so let's remain there. So one glucose molecule will consume 3 moles of phenyl hydrazine to give you ozone. So what can happen? So 1 mole of aniline and 1 mole of ammonia has been consumed. So here what can happen? I will tell you, 2 moles of phenyl hydrazines are involved in addition, and one of the
phenylhydrazine is involved in oxidation. Okay, that's how three moles are there. So I will discuss that in the next class. Don't worry about that. Different carbohydrates form ozone with different melting point and crystal structure allow you to identify the aldose. C2 apimers give the same ozone. Ketones usually react more slowly. So in this case what happens? Ketones are react very slowly in comparison to glucose, but the product will be same. Other reactions. Monosaccharides are stable in dilute acid. Strong acid can dehydrate or break chains. Dilute bases can cause rearrangement. I already told you, fructose undergo rearrangement to give you an equilibrium mixture of glucose and mannose. Strong base can fragment the chain. That is very, very important. Okay. Monosaccharides can be interconverted using several different reactions. Apimerization, there are two types of things you will undergo in the next class. One is anomerization, other is apimerization. So these three, four things we will discuss in the next class. How anomerization and apimerization and rearrangement in ketones and in case of ozone happens. Okay, then rough degradation means you have to decrease the number of carbon atom in a given aldose or ketose, and one is extended the chain, that is Killani Fischer synthesis. So rough degradation and Killani Fischer synthesis are very, very important. Okay, rough degradation means you have to decrease the number of carbon atom in a given aldose, and Killani Fischer is what? So in rough degradation we will use actually the Hofmann bromide reaction, and in Killani Fischer we will use two reaction. One is addition reaction of HCN and then reduction of CN to aldehyde. So reduction of CN to aldehyde, you know, diisobutyl aluminium hydride is one of the best reagent. Now next reaction is that aldehyde, or you can say here in this case glucose, reacts with red phosphorus and HI and give you hexane. This reaction is of prime importance. Why? Because it tells us that glucose is a straight chain, carbon chain of 6 carbon atom. Okay, so hexane, in a few cases you may also get a few traces of 2-iodohexane also. So repeating once more, hexane is the main product, but in traces you may get 2-iodohexane also. But if the same glucose molecule react with sodium in amalgamation, then you will get sorbitol. In what happens, the aldehyde will also transform into a primary alkali group, then sorbitol is formed. What happens, sorbitol is formed. This reaction is with both the reactions are very, very important and confirms that glucose is a straight chain compound. Next reaction is about the acylation. Now if the aldehyde is acylated by using acetyl chloride, then what happens? Wherever OH group is present, those OH group will be what? They will undergo esterification. So what can happen? So with acyl halide, all alcoholic, primary alcoholic and secondary alcoholic group, they undergo acylation and confirm that presence of 5-OHO group. So this reaction is also important. Why? Because this reaction confirms that. This reaction confirms that what? That there are 5-OH group in glucose molecule. Similarly, if the same reaction happens in presence of PCl5, you will have formation of pentachloroglucose. That also states us what? That there are 5-OH group in glucose.